Okay, so now that we have talked about why we are studying engineering dynamics, we want to answer the next question, which is, what does it really consist of? What are we exactly going to study in engineering dynamics? Now, engineering dynamics is traditionally divided into two topics. One is called kinematics, which is defined as geometry of motion. Geometry of motion. Now, what is geometry of motion? Well, when we talk about kinematics or geometry of motion, we're not really concerned with the force and the moments that give rise to the motion. Now, remember, if you have a particle, if you have a rigid body that is moving and is accelerating in some ways, then there is a force or a moment applied on it. But we're not really thinking about the forces. We're just looking at a particle or a rigid body, and we look at its motion, okay? What its velocity is, what its acceleration is. So when we talk about the geometry of motion, we are looking at trajectories, we are looking at the path, we are looking at what rate the particle is moving along those paths. We are talking about the rate of the velocity, which is defined as acceleration along the path. So it just looks like the geometry. There isn't much dynamics in that. So that's the reason why kinematics is called geometry of motion. So some of the things that we will study in the geometry of motion will be the displacement, the velocity, and the acceleration. So those are the three quantities of interest in kinematics. And we will talk about what the position of a particle is, what the position of a rigid body is, what the velocity and acceleration are for both particle and the rigid body. The other constituent of dynamics is called kinetics. Now, kinetics is really the study of forces and the motion. Forces and the motion. And this double-sided arrow is basically indicating that forces give rise to the motion, and motion can give rise to the forces. So this is where we're talking about what is the nature of the force and how the forces relate to the motion. And if you're thinking about Newton's second law, then you're thinking in the right direction, because you know that Newton's second law says that some of the forces applied on a particle or rigid body is equal to mass times its acceleration. And this is basically something that relates forces with the motion, which in this case is acceleration. Okay, so now let's talk about some of the fundamental concepts. The first fundamental concept that we will talk about is the concept of space. Now, the space that we will deal with basically be a three-dimensional space, the kind of space in which we live, or at least we perceive to live in. And the concept of a space we will consider to be an absolute one. So we will talk about things that will be positioned at a certain location in this three-dimensional space, and most of the time we will show this three-dimensional space via a Cartesian coordinate system where a particle might be or a rigid body might be. Now, a rigid body is of course not going to be treated as a particle, so it'll occupy a part of the space which will be more than just a point. And we'll consider the concept of a space to be absolute one. Okay, so the second concept that we will talk about is the concept of time. Now, we will consider time to be absolute as well, which means that every observer observing an event can use the same clock without a problem. Although you know that Einstein's theory of relativity rejects that assumption, time is actually not absolute in Einstein's theory. However, for the purpose of this class, we'll consider time to be absolute, which means that the duration of the events would not depend on the observer who may be moving or not. The third concept is the concept of force. Now, you've seen the concept of force before in your other classes, maybe Mech 101, maybe Mech 260 engineering studies class, either here or somewhere else. And if I ask you to define what a force is, you might say that, well, force is actually a push or a pull. So if you take an object, you know, you push it or you pull it, let's say we call this force F of pull, and this is the force F of, this is really push, not pull. So let me just write push, but assume that, you know, this is what it is. So we have a force of push, we have a force of pull, and you might say that that's what a force is. Well, that's just a qualitative description of what a force might be. But that doesn't really define, you know, what a force is. So then maybe you are thinking, I can define the force as mass times acceleration, which is basically nothing but the Newton's second law. Well, again, the force is not defined by a relationship. This is just a relationship between forces and the acceleration. So let me give you an example. I am my parent's son. That's a relationship that I have with my parents. That doesn't define me. It's the same case with the forces also. So to be something is specific. So when we talk about the definition of a force, that would depend on the nature of interaction between two objects. So for example, if I have a block and that block is resting on ground, then we know that, you know, if you draw the free body diagram of this block, which means that you draw it separately without showing the ground, then the Earth's gravitational pull is trying to bring it down, right? And let we'll call it F sub G. And then you also have the normal reaction between the ground and the block. So over here, there are two forces that are essentially acting on the block. We have the gravitational pull of Earth, and we have the normal reaction from the ground applied on the block. So if we talk about the force of gravity, then that's an interaction that we have between the block and the Earth's gravitational pull. And what is this number? This is basically the mass of the object times the gravitational acceleration. In this case, the normal reaction would happen to be same as the F sub g or mg. So gravity is a force which is defined by m times g. If let's say the same object was being pushed on this ground, then you might assume that there is some friction between the block and the ground. Let's call it F sub f. Now, what that friction force would be will depend on whether the object is moving or not. If the object is moving, you know that you'll have kinetic coefficient of friction multiplied by the normal reaction to define the friction force. So that is the definition of a friction force. So every definition of the force would be different depending on what the interaction is. A third concept that we want to talk about is the concept of mass. So what is mass? Mass is basically nothing but a measure of the total amount of matter in an object, right? So a measure of amount of matter. Mass is considered to be almost an axiomatic property, which means that you cannot define it using something more elementary. A fifth property is the inertia. Now, inertia is actually an umbrella term that consists of both mass as well as distribution of mass. Now, the question is, why do we really need both mass as well as distribution of mass? We'll soon see that we will model physical systems, physical bodies as either particles or rigid bodies. When you model something as a particle, then it is sufficient to just talk about its mass. But when you model a physical system as a rigid body, then you have to talk about the mass as well as how that mass is distributed in the space. So if you're thinking about moment of inertia, about different axes, then you're thinking in the right direction. Okay, two more concepts that we need to talk about are the concept of particle and rigid bodies. So in most of the problems, we will have to model actual physical objects either as particle or as rigid body. We will neglect the possibility that things deform. In reality, they may actually deform, but we will neglect that as a possibility. So particles, what are particles? Well, if you have taken a math class or a physics class, you may have come across things modeled as particles, but they were really mathematical particles. They didn't have a mass, they didn't have a shape or a size or a volume. In engineering dynamics, particles are basically point objects. They don't have a volume or an area, but they do have a mass, and they are called engineering particles, and that's how engineering particles really differ from mathematical particles. So when can you model a physical object as a particle? Well, it depends on what your interests are in. What are you really trying to answer? So if you're looking for, let's say, certain kinds of properties where distribution of the mass is not important, then you can model something as a particle. So big objects like aeroplane can be modeled as a particle if you are interested in studying their motion, let's say, you know, if it flies from New York to Tokyo. You're less concerned about how much the wings are deforming or they're bending as it, you know, goes from New York to Tokyo. You're also not concerned about its rotation. So when that's the case, you can model it as a particle. So a particle basically is just a point, and all it can do is move along a path. It cannot have its own rotation as such. So when we talk about rotation in engineering, we are really not talking about rotation of a particle along a certain path. So for example, a particle could travel along a path which could be circular. Well, this is the center, so it's basically this is the velocity and it's moving like this, okay? But there is no change in orientation of this particle because by definition, particle doesn't have a shape or a size. On the other hand, if this object was not modeled as a particle but more like as, let's say, a square, and it was traveling along the same circular path, it could be allowed to change its orientation. So maybe at time t it was here, at time t plus delta t it was here, and you can see that actually the orientation is now changing. Because if you look at, let's say, this particular edge, which is almost vertical over here, is now tilted, right? And that means that it has actually changed the orientation. So this is what we mean by rotation for the physical objects treated as rigid body. So let's talk about rigid bodies. In reality, engineering dynamics is really dynamics of rigid bodies. Dynamics of particles is something that you have already studied in your physics class. So we will talk about the dynamics of particles, but our focus is really on the dynamics of rigid bodies. So what are rigid bodies? Well, rigid bodies, as the name implies, are bodies that don't deform. So if you have an object modeled as a rigid body, and if you take two points on this object, as it moves, the distance between the two points should not change. And that's how we define a rigid body. So rigid body, by definition, doesn't deform, and it has a shape or a size, which means that if you want to talk about its inertial properties, you will have to talk about both the mass as well as various moment of inertia. So when can you model something as a rigid body? Well, again, it depends on what kind of question you are trying to answer. If the question asks for deformation, then surely you cannot treat a physical object as a rigid body. But if the question is essentially asking for things which can be answered by assuming an object to be a rigid body, then that would suffice.